Just so good to be with you, brothers and sisters, God's people here at this church. We are encouraged by our time here already. Look forward to being with the Lord's people tomorrow as well. So let's go back to 1 Thessalonians, and this session, we'll move a little bit more quickly than the other two, and get us to have some lunch together and fellowship over lunch with some dialogue about the Christian life and about the text we've considered. So again, we're thinking about the church. I trust you've picked up on that so far. We're thinking about the church together. I trust you picked up on the fact I think it's important. The Bible values the church, places a premium on the church. And so for us, again, the Christian life is to be lived out in the context of community with God's people, growing together, loving one another, learning together, mentoring one another, reaching the world together for the cause of Christ. So we see in this letter to this church, these believers at Thessalonica, Paul is commending them, he's thanking them, he's rejoicing with them in what they're doing. And in chapter 1 is really like Paul's assessment of this church. And that's a careful thing. Paul assesses churches on numerous occasions in the New Testament. Some of them get better scores than others. Thus, the church at Thessalonica may get the best score of all. And so chapter 1, he's just walking through why he's grateful for this church, what's taking place that is worthy of commendation. So for us as believers now, 2 millennia later, we get to look back and see what Paul is affirming, what Paul is commending, what Paul is instructing, and then make application to our lives, make application to our churches. So we've seen a number of things as it relates to the type of church God blesses, the type of church Christ desires to build. We saw in verse 1, that this church was comprised of saved individuals. They were in God, in the Lord Jesus Christ. We saw in chapters 2 and 3 that this was a serving church. They worked together. We saw in chapter 4 this church was doctrinally informed, doctrinally sound, we might say. We saw in chapter 5 this church celebrated strong preaching. This church experienced strong preaching. We saw in verse 6 that this church was willing to suffer for the cause of Christ, and Paul commended them. Now, in these last few verses, we see four other marks or signs or distinctives of a healthy church. And the next sign we see is in verse 6, and that is this church was a church that demonstrated leadership. Notice verse 7. Verse 6, Paul is commending them, their faith, standing strong, imitating them in the gospel, receiving the word amid much opposition. They had done so in such a sterling way that verse 7, they had become an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. Again, one of these little phrases that is easy to kind of just see as a throwaway phrase and move on. But when we read our Bibles, when we read passages like this, we need to always remember that, you know, verse 7 or chapter 1, it's not just a pileup of words. Sometimes when we come to list, whether it's at the end of a letter or a list or some other section where we can just kind of begin to glance over if nothing strikes us of immediate importance, but the Bible is not comprised of different piles of words. Every word matters. Every verse matters. Every phrase matters. Verse 7 matters. Because in verse 7, we see where Paul commends this church because they demonstrated leadership. Their faith was strong enough. It had withstood opposition. They were growing in the Lord through much tribulation. So much so, other churches in the region, Macedonia and in Achaia, other churches in proximity are seeing it. They're being encouraged by it. They're drawing strength from it as well. Thus, they're demonstrating leadership to the churches in the region. Now, as I've thought about this verse, especially as it relates to our time together this weekend, here, our believers, especially at Makakilo Baptist Church on this island, verse 7 has taken on increased importance by the day. Because I reflect upon this congregation where God has stationed you guys. You guys are uniquely positioned to be such a church as the believers in Thessalonica. You're on an island here in the middle of the Pacific. And an island, Oahu, that of course the culture in Oahu, this isn't Bible Belt territory. This is a culture in Oahu and a population that's pretty secular. But not just that, if you think beyond this island to what is taking place in the broader Asiatic region, You go east, and I know you guys have ministries in different nations in the Asian landmass, China, and then further south in different areas there. You're able to reach out and be a lighthouse. On this island, you begin to look at Baptist churches. There aren't that many, right? There aren't that many evangelical churches. And you begin to look at the different evangelical churches on this island, and there aren't that many, and this church is a strong church by comparison. So I want to challenge you for a few moments to think through this verse in light of your own ministry here and perhaps how God has positioned you to, in a special way, fulfill verse 7 as this mark, this distinctive of a church that is healthy, a church that supplies leadership. There are really a couple of different questions we should ask of ourselves in light of verse 7. That is, how and where they provided such leadership. How and where a church can give such leadership. We know of these believers here in verse 7, this leadership, this witness, this testimony they projected, first and foremost, was a gospel testimony amid much opposition. So, in our little break we had, that we just got to go drink some snacks and take a break, had a couple different people visit with me or speak to me about the way my previous point resonated about feeling the different cultural pressures from neighbors, from friends, the workplace, where this is a little flashpoint. So, part of what we do as a church on any given Lord's Day is we come together, we gather together, we sing together, we're fed the word together, and we get kind of a shot in the arm. A shot in the arm, a spiritual dose to strengthen us for another week of service. So we encourage one another to be strong. We encourage one another to grow in the faith and to project our witness. And as we do that one to another, we also are able to project and radiate that witness to others. So one way you are particularly equipped in verse 7 to fulfill this verse is to be such a witness to other churches on this island. The folks see this church strategically positioned as fulfilling the spirit of this verse, and they see your influence, and they draw encouragement from it. Radiating from this island as you think beyond to this side of the globe and where God has positioned you and the influence you're able to give as you go eastward. Look, I've preached east, and it gets either dramatically better or dramatically worse for the gospel. You go into a nation like Korea. South Korea is a nation that has, you know, massive churches. I've preached there in churches that 30,000 people in attendance, massive churches. And the nation of South Korea sends more missionaries external than any other country on the planet, save the United States. So the nation of South Korea, for instance, a very strong gospel witness. But you go beyond South Korea, what do you see in China? You see the good, the bad, the ugly, right? You see a government that officially is repressive of the church, but you see an underground church movement that is exploding. Tens of millions of people gathering in underground churches and house churches for the Lord Jesus Christ. You go south into India, what do you see? You see the opposite. You have governments can do so, a government that's not particularly adversarial, but you see a Christian population that is less than 1% of a nation now of 1.2 billion people. You go to the nation of Japan, what do you see? You see a nation that in many ways is a Western nation as far as their governmental structure, as far as their economy, as far as even how they dress, interact one with another. In many ways, it's a Western nation. Yet, and it's in with a government that is not hostile to Christianity, but what do we see? We see a church there that is microscopic. So my point is, it's one thing for a church in the mainland to think globally and to think about reaching the continent of Asia, but it's another thing for a church here strategically positioned in the middle of two great land masses, in the middle of two great continents, to think eastwardly, to think that direction about reaching them for Christ. And not just the people, but the churches there that need to be served. So I'm saying this to you to say, I know you guys are doing a lot, and I want to encourage you to excel still more. That God has positioned you on this place not merely for this island, but for the continent that lays beyond you to continue to serve and reach them. So that's one way you can fulfill that call. Additionally, think of how you think of that call not only as you project your beliefs and what the convictions you have, but also as you think of where you can project those beliefs, where you can engage on this island and off, so the church supplies leadership. And that is important, even in light of verse 6 as it relates to the cultural pressures we face, the pressures the church faces and the pressure believers face as we come together and we remind ourselves that we are one in the Lord and we grow together. So 6, they demonstrated leadership. 7th distinctive, verse 8, This was an evangelistic church. Verse 8. This was an evangelistic church. Verse 8. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith toward God has gone forth, so that we have no need to say anything. Now, this verse 8 to me is kind of like verse 5, a verse where there's a lot packed in here that has much to say to us. Notice there are three, as I read verse 8, three questions come to mind. What did they share? How did they share it? And where did they share it? Notice first question, what did they share? Notice verse 8. The word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place your faith toward God has gone forth. So notice what they share. Two things. The word of the Lord went forth. Also, their faith in God. The word of the Lord, their faith in God. So in essence, their message is this. They're preaching the gospel, the word of God, but also they are personalizing that and speaking, testifying as to how the word of God has impacted them, how they came to faith in Christ, their conversion story, their experience growing in Christ. Both of those go forth. First, the word of the Lord. Now, as a church, as believers, that message is predetermined. It is preset. It is not for us to kind of meet annually and figure out what the message is going to be. You don't have a committee in the church, you know, a doctrine study committee that figures out year to year what we need to be preaching or teaching. We don't look to the Southern Baptist Convention or other church networks to tell us what our message is. The message, first and foremost, is the gospel itself. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 5. Flesh this out. He said, now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved. If you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he then appeared to Cephas and to the 12. So what is the message? The word that went forth was the gospel message that is a perennial message. A perennial message from generation to generation, from era to era, from witnessing church to witnessing church, is the message that we send out. My wife and I were traveled overseas just a few weeks ago, and we were overseas for about a week, not a particularly long trip. We got to minister in different settings. We got to go, we were in Israel for a while, and we were in the West Bank partnering with missionaries there and encouraging them and serving with them for a while. And to see that message in the West Bank, which they're ministering to a group of people that are largely not Christian, to see that message that is being preached in the West Bank to Palestinians, to Jews, and to other people that are traveling through that area, to see that message preached. So, I'm preaching in Kansas City one week, which sounds and feels a lot like this. Go to the West Bank, which the people, the appearance, the culture, the religious expectations and convictions that show up in the room sound a lot different. And a few days later, we're in Cairo. How many of you guys have been to Cairo? Anyone? Cairo is one of the largest cities on the planet, about 25 million people. Massive city. The city itself is about 99.something% Muslim. Coptic Christians, if you've been following the news over the past 5 or so years, the Coptic Christian, the Christian church in Egypt has been facing massive persecution, intense displacement. The nation, the city itself, the capital city, is predominantly, overwhelmingly Muslim. What do? You preach there. I got to preach some different settings there. I got to see ministry taking place in different settings there and got to preach that message, whether it's in Cairo, whether it's in the Holy Land, whether it's in Kansas City, whether it's in Hawaii. The very root of that message is perennial. It is not bound by time or place. It is the message, this man, Jesus, is God's Son. This man, Jesus, is the only Savior. So they shared the word of the Lord, that message, and then built out from that message, but also their faith in God. Their faith in God, it's not an abstract message. It also has been affected by them. Their life has been changed through that message. The gospel has redirected their life. And so they preach something that they have experienced. They preach something that they have felt in their bones. They preach a message that has impacted their life. And I want to be real clear here, brothers and sisters, because often we think of our preaching, our teaching, our evangelistic witness as being only or almost entirely in that first category, the message of the word. And so you think, well, I don't have a seminary degree. I'm not trained in the scriptures well enough. And so we put a pretty low threshold on our own capacity to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. We should always be growing in the truth of Scripture. We should be ongoing students, lifelong students of the Word of God. But listen to me clearly. Our first instinct to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ doesn't come after we've had 8 years of theological training or 8 years of small group leadership. It comes when we are converted. I grew up in a Christian church, a large church in Mobile, Alabama, which has been noted already. And a church, a Bible-believing church. I grew up in that church. I heard Bible preached every Sunday. But I didn't become a Christian until my freshman year in college. I knew the gospel. I heard it preached 1,000 times, but there never been repentance and faith, never been converted, never been actually impacted by the gospel. Until one Sunday morning, my freshman year in gospel, I'm there at church. God had been working in my life for a period of months. I've been under conviction for a period of weeks. The Spirit had been wooing me. I've been feeling an emptiness of heart, needing something, wanting something. I go to church one Sunday, and the gospel message I had heard 1,000 times, that Sunday I heard it for the first time with the ears of faith. I become a believer. I don't know much at all about the Bible. Because though I had been sitting in church for 18 years, I had been daydreaming for 18 years. I didn't know much at all about theology. I didn't know much at all about the church. I didn't know much at all about connecting the dots of Scripture. I didn't know much about anything. But I knew that I had been changed. So that day, not knowing better, I just got my car that Sunday afternoon and began to drive around town. Went to a couple of old high school buddies' houses. Told them what had happened to me that morning. Went back to my dormitory that afternoon and met with the guys on my college basketball team and told them what had happened. I'd become a Christian and I was going to be living differently and they would see that in me differently. That night at practice, I met with our coach and said, Coach, and our coach was not a believing man. I said, here's what's happened to me. I became a Christian this morning at church and I'm becoming a follower of Christ, and I don't expect that to impact my playing on the team, but I want you to know that something very significantly had happened in my life and I've been changed. And so I need to miss practice next Monday evening because I want to be baptized then. And he looked at me bug-eyed as though I'd have how audacious it was for me to suggest I miss practice for that. And I said, well, we have this special service on Monday night. Our Sunday night service is being moved to Monday night at our church, and I want to be baptized then. And he reluctantly agreed. And what was going on? I hadn't been like through a 3-month-long class on witnessing. I hadn't been through an 8-week mentorship on how to share my faith. Hadn't read any curriculum. But something in here had changed. A new heart had been given to me. And in my own childlike, elementary, innocent way, it was beginning to get external what had happened internal. Turn with me to John chapter 9. I want us to just think about this for a few moments. John chapter 9. One of these great scenes that makes this truth clear for us. Remember John chapter 9. Remember what's going on. Jesus heals a man born blind. The Pharisees, the Jewish leadership, who are always seeking to ensnare Jesus, seeking to put him to death for claiming to be God, always seeking to ensnare Jesus. Notice what takes place beginning in chapter 9, verse 1. As he passed by, he saw a man blind from birth, referring to Jesus. And Jesus and his disciples, asked him, his disciples asked Jesus, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents that he would be born blind. In other words, in their mind, someone had to sin. A physical infirmity was the cause of sin. Either parents sin, this being the child is being judged, or this individual sin. It doesn't just happen. It had to be the result of sin. Jesus answered verse 3, "It was neither that this man sinned nor his parents, but it was so that the works of God might be displayed in him." By the way, that is a really good verse to remember. Because when circumstances come into your life, whether it's a physical infirmity or some other dislocation, some other challenge, remember, it may not be the result of sin. It may be. It may not be. It may be that God is providing you an arena to display his glory. Verse 4. Jesus says, "We must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he said this, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle and applied the clay to his eyes. And he said to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam." So he went away and washed, and he came back seeing. Therefore, the neighbors and those who previously saw him as a beggar were saying, "Is not this the one who used to sit and beg?" And others were saying, "This is he." Still others were saying, "No, but he's like him. He looks like him." But this man said, "No, I am the one." So they were saying to him, "How then were your eyes open?" And this man said, "The man who is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' So I went away and washed and I received sight." And they said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I don't know." And notice verse 13 is where he gets really intriguing. The Pharisees, they brought the man who was formerly blind. They brought to the Pharisees the man who was formerly blind. Now, it was a Sabbath on the day when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes. Aha, we have a trap. Jesus evidently has healed on the Sabbath. The Pharisees were asking him again, how he received his sight. And he said to them, "He applied clay to my eyes, and I washed, and I see." Therefore, some of the Pharisees were saying, "This man is not from God, because he does not keep the Sabbath." But others were saying, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" So there was a division among them. Some were saying, "He's healed on the Sabbath. Clearly, he's not sent from God." Others were saying, "Well, but he's got some power. He just healed a guy who was blind." So they said to the blind man, again, "What do you say about him? Since he opened your eyes, what's your assessment?" He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews then did not believe it of him, that he had been blind and had received sight. So now they're trying to explain away the miracle. So they go to this guy's parents in verse 18 and they ask him, "Is this your son who was born blind? Then how does he see?" His parents answered and said to them, "We know that this is our son. This is the one who was born blind. But how he now sees, we don't know. We don't know who opened his eyes." Verse 21, "Why don't you ask him? He is of age. He can speak for himself. He's an adult." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone confessed him to be Christ, if anyone professed Jesus to be the Messiah, he would be put out of the synagogue, and that was a harsh judgment, to be severed in their minds, to be severed from God. Verse 23, "For this reason his parents said, 'He is of age, ask him.' So a second time," verse 24, "they called the man who had been blind and said to him, 'Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner.'" Now notice verse 25. This is the money verse. "He then answered, 'Whether he is a sinner, I do not know. But one thing I do know. Though I was blind, now I see.'" He's saying, "I don't understand your religious squabble. I don't get the political drama behind your beef you have with this man, Jesus. I don't even understand why you're calling me here today to interrogate me. But you want to hear my response? I was blind. This man made me see." Now, the punch for us is not a form of spiritual reductionism where we seek to know nothing and just to kind of stumble through life and only give elementary answers. My point is this: if you wait until you know the Bible as you've always aspired to know it before you become a witness, you'll just never become a witness. It's kind of like the people that are going to wait till they can afford to have children before they have children. If you wait till you can afford to have children, guess what? You'll never have children. We have 5 young children. We had to process that in early years of marriage. You finally realize, you know what? If we wait till everything's squared away, we'll just never have children. Things will never be squared away. If you wait until you've mastered the Scripture to become a witness for Christ, you'll never become a witness for Christ, because the more you learn about the Bible, the more you realize you don't know. And the more you study the Scripture, the more you want to study the Scripture. The more you develop doctrinally, theologically, the more you'll see you need to develop doctrinally, theologically. And oh, here's the dirty little secret, by the way. The critics out there who might question you about your faith, they know even less than you do, so don't be intimidated by them. What did they share? What took place? Paul says to these believers, two things happened. Verse 8, the word of the Lord, the message of the gospel has went forth, and your faith toward God. Now, we'll see a little later in this chapter that their faith towards God led them to a radical change. So the world is looking, seeing these people that are together, they're in community together, they gather together on the Lord's Day evidently, they break bread together, they're communing together, they're different, they're young and old, they're rich, they're poor, they're educated, they're uneducated. The only common factor about them is this man Jesus who they're following. And what they're doing is they're going into the marketplace, into the workplace, into their family and their friends, and they haven't mastered the Scriptures, but they do know this: we were blind, and now we see. The word went forth. So notice what we see. First, the message they shared was the word of the Lord, and their faith in God, their personal faith in God, their personal testimony, their personal conversion. Notice, secondly, notice how they shared it. I love the tenor of verse 8. It sounded forth. The word of the Lord has sounded forth. This phrase literally means to blast forth, to shout forth with intensity. Outside the New Testament, this phrase was used for blowing a trumpet, the sound attributed to rolling thunder. And so Paul is saying that it went forth boldly, loudly, literally. It continually went forth. That is the message that went. Now stay with me. How are people saved? Through Jesus. How do people know of Jesus? Through you. Through me. That's the great logic of Romans chapter 10. Remember Romans chapter 10, where Paul begins to expound upon the beauty of the gospel and the message of the gospel. Then he asks us, how will they believe unless they have heard? How will they hear unless we preach? How will we preach unless they are sent? So the message goes from us, both from those of us vocationally in ministry who preach the word in contexts like this, but also from all of us rolling out from our lives. It went forth. And then notice the third question: where did they share it? Macedonia and Achaia. What does that mean? He's touching on the regionality of their message. So now stay with me here. I mentioned to you last night about Thessalonica and the gospel going there. And Paul, under the leadership of the Spirit, always had a knack for taking the gospel to places the gospel could radiate out from. His great passion to go to Rome to preach the gospel in Rome. Rome was the hub of the civilized world. Rome was like Washington, D.C. and New York City rolled into one. The financial, political, cultural, military capital of the world. Rome. And Paul wanted to go see it preached there so he could go out from there. Thessalonica, to a lesser degree, but a similar fashion. Paul wanted to see the church established there because on this Ignatian way, as travelers came and went east to Asia, west to Rome. Now, what does that mean for us? What does it mean for you? Brothers and sisters, you are in a special place. First of all, you're on an island in the middle of nowhere. But that's God's beauty, to take this island in the middle of an ocean, these islands in the middle of an ocean. And who comes here? Everybody. Everybody. You're inundated with visitors, with tourists. And as the gospel here is radiating from a strong church, radiating from a group of believers, it goes out from here all over the world. And oh, by the way, one added aspect of that. What does this island have in highly dense form? It has military bases, military camps, military posts, military outposts. And if I know anything about the military, I know people are coming and growing faster than you can count them. I pastored by Fort Knox for 4 years, and man, every month people are coming, people are going, and then you have a certain seasonality where a lot of people would go, and then a few weeks later, a lot of people start coming, and this in and out, and it was both exhilarating and maddening as a pastor, because it was exhilarating because these new people would come in by the waves, and you get to meet them and minister to them and grow with them, and it'd be maddening because just as you got to know them well and develop a strong relationship, then they go out. But what we saw in ministering in that military context is that the gospel message was going out, and so we even had in our church a map, an atlas of the world. And we had little pins that would pin in where different families were now serving or living. And over the years, we saw the gospel going out from our church all over the world, literally. You have that same potential here. For the military side of things, or just through the life side of things, as people come and go, so understand the message goes forth traveling throughout the globe. What do they share? The word of God, their personal testimony. How do they share it? Evidently, boldly. It went forth, sounded forth. Where do they share it? Macedonia, Achaia, in the spirit of Acts 1:8, to their uttermost parts of the earth. Notice the eighth distinctive of a healthy church in verse 9. The eighth distinctive of the healthy church in verse 9. It is a sanctified church. Notice verse 9. Here's what people are saying about these believers. They themselves report about us, what kind of reception we had with you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God. What does this mean? People are saying, people observing, when the apostles came and preached, these people received their message. They received the message preached. And that is a good thing. No one wants to preach to a group of people that are sitting back with arms folded and a smirk on their face. You want to preach to someone who's got a notepad out or got their Bible open and following along and nodding and engaging. And Paul is saying that's what these people did. God was working in their life and conviction was taking place and they were receiving the word. They weren't skeptical. They weren't cynical. They weren't distracted. They received it. So much so, how do you know? How does Paul know? Well, notice the end of verse 9. Word on the street was that they were divesting themselves of idols. Word on the street was that they were divesting themselves of idols. Paul is saying, we know you received the word of the Lord. We saw it. But oh, in case we needed added verification, added authentication of the legitimacy of your faith, life change was taking place. Life change was taking place. What is an idol? An idol is anything or anyone you put above the greatest commandment of all, to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. An idol is something you value above the Lord Jesus Christ. An idol is something that competes for your devotion, for your resources. An idol is something that competes for your affection. An idol is something that you long for more than Christ. An idol is something that you want to give yourself to more than Christ. An idol is something that, again, has worship-like features in your heart where you devote yourself to it. In the ancient world, a more primitive people, idols tended to be what you think of as an idol, an object, or a sun god, or emperor worship. something that we would look at and say, now, isn't that bizarre? Those people were so primitive. They worship blocks of stone. They worship the sun god. They worship the emperor. They worship the goddess Diana. Those people were so primitive. Think about how they literally worshiped idols. The modern missionary movement of the 18th century and the 19th century, when missionaries went out, and often they would encounter in sub-Saharan Africa and South America, places that were more primitive, that were not yet had been civilized. They would encounter people that worship, literal idols, things made of the hand. Now, I don't think that's our danger here this morning. I don't think that's the danger of modern man, but I do know this: we are still an idolatrous people. Whether it's the Ben Franklins we worship, or the new cars, or the houses, or some stage of life, or some human accomplishment, whatever it is, that thing that competed for the affection, that thing that was functioning as a god in the heart, that thing or item or people or persons or events that had their devotion. Paul says, you guys were walking away from it. They had turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God. Karen and I have a friend, an old friend, haven't talked to in years, from Mobile. His name is Richard Burton. Richard Burton became a believer in his 30s. And Richard, before he became a believer, he owned a nightclub known as the Pandora's Box. That was the name of his nightclub. And I was never in it. Never been to it, but it evidently was a raunchy place. It had a bad reputation. It was known to be a raunchy place, and he owned this nightclub called the Pandora's Box. Richard gets saved. He becomes a believer, and he doesn't bump up against Christianity. He gets the full dose. He owns this nightclub. What does he do about it? Well, you could think, well, I guess he's going to sell it. He'll sell the nightclub to someone else who wants to manage the nightclub. He'll divest himself of that, and he'll get out of the nightclub business and become an upstanding person with an upstanding business or job. Richard was thinking more severely than that. Richard went and burned the place down. Richard, I'm not saying that is the only course of action one could take, but that was Richard's course of action. Richard decided, I don't want to sell this nightclub to someone else to perpetuate the sin that's taking place. He went and firebombed it and burned it to the ground, and he didn't get insurance money out of it. It wasn't one of those deals. He just went and burned it down. He was so convicted. I'll tell you what, that might be a little severe, but there's no questioning about where his new affections were. There's no questioning about his new way of life. There's no confusion about whether or not Richard was going to follow Christ. There's no lack of clarity as to whether or not he really meant this thing known as Christianity. He burned it down. We get a sense of that in verse 9, don't we? We get a sense of that. They turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God. Time is passing, but we see in places like 1 John 1:16 and 1 John 2:15 this change of life that takes place. Let's just turn there briefly. 1 John chapter 1 and 1 John chapter 2, where we get a sense of this, of willingness to change, this spiritual ricochet that takes place. 1 John, beginning in chapter 1, verse 5. This is the message we have heard from him and announced to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness. Notice what he says. Walk doesn't say we stumble into darkness or slip into darkness or momentarily engage in darkness, but he says as a pattern of life, if we walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his son cleanses us from all sin. Notice chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love the world, nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life, is not from the Father, but is from the world. The world is passing away, and also its lusts, but the one who does the will of God lives forever. This church was a sanctified church. Please hear me, not perfection. Guys, we are fallen people. We take one step forwards, two step backwards, two steps forward, one step backwards. Your pastor does that. I do that. I am not suggesting that, you know, there's some level of spiritual perfection that's out there. But as I said last night, we are called to make a little progress along the way. That people see us and say, well, yeah, he says he's a Christian. She says she's a Christian. And yeah, their life has a different flavor to it. Where people look at us and say, man, I'm not quite sure what understands. I don't get this Christianity thing. But all I know is these people have changed. They have turned to God from their idols. All right, let's land the plane here with the ninth distinctive in verse 10. The ninth distinctive in verse 10. And that is, a healthy church, a church that God is blessing, is a church that longs for the coming of Christ. Notice verse 10. To wait for his Son from heaven, whom he has raised from the dead, that is Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath to come. Now this book, if we were to read it this morning, it would go something like this. Chapter 1, marks of a healthy church. Chapter 2, marks of a faithful ministry as Paul defends and outlines his ministry among them. Chapter 3, we get into just basic issues of Christian living. And then chapters 4 and 5, towards in the book, we get into Christian living, especially in light of the return of Christ. And what was taking place in the first century was there was a great deal of sensationalism around the return of Christ. There was confusion around the return of Christ. Some people were thinking it was so imminent, they were quitting their jobs. They were no longer working. They were not caring for their families. They were anticipating Christ to come back any moment. So Paul would say things in 1 Thessalonians and things in 2 Thessalonians like, if you don't work, you shouldn't eat. He would say things like, you should care for your family. He would say things like continue to be faithful in the small things, continue to live your lives, continue to be responsible. Because they were so sensationalizing the return of Christ that they were giving up caring for themselves and living their lives and just sitting on a hillside waiting for Jesus, so to speak. We've seen a touch of that before in the 1970s and 80s, especially when there was this great intrigue and interest in eschatological things and end time matters, and people were waiting. And throughout in the 20th century, on several different occasions, there were false leaders, religious leaders, who would say, Jesus is coming back on such and such a date, and they would predict it, and they would get a little band of followers to wait, and Jesus didn't come back. And they would say, but I had the date slightly wrong. He's coming back on such and such a date. And they would predict it and wait, and Jesus wouldn't come back. And so at the end of the 20th century, the church had this heightened sense of kind of prophecy awareness. There were a lot of prophecy conferences and events like this. A guy like me would have a chart behind him and talk about this is going to happen, and this is going to happen, and this is going to happen. And the church throughout its history has been more or less sort of sitting up and waiting for Jesus to return. I think that we maybe have overcorrected a touch in the past 20 to 30 years. And by that I mean this. We are not to be so sensationalized in the return of Christ that we sit around expecting it to be any day. We certainly are not to be so sensationalizing that we get to banding people together to kind of collectively wait. But if we don't live our Christian lives understanding that Jesus could come back any moment, we are missing the urgency of Christian ministry and of the Christian life. Martin Luther famously said, I have 2 days on my calendar, this day and that day, the day that Jesus returns. So Paul will tell them in this book, in chapter 4 and 5, he'll describe what it looks like when Jesus comes back. He's consoling them that those who have died in Christ are not going to be left behind. Jesus will gain them too. He fleshes out what that will look like, and he tells the church, you should be ready. So as he clarifies them and kicks them in the seat of their pants not to be complacent with their jobs, not to neglect their families that are waiting on Jesus to return, again, it's a measure correction because in verse 10, he commends them for waiting for Jesus, for his Son from heaven to come, and who will do what? Rescue us from the wrath to come. Now, my encouragement for you and for the 21st century evangelical churches, we need to be leaning into this a touch more. We need to be expecting Jesus to come back. I know some pastors who their ambitions for their church and their building plans for their church are so ambitious that I think they would be disappointed if Jesus came back. I know certain people have their life so planned and, you know, that they got everything choreographed what they want to do, that I think Jesus coming back would be a disruption to their best laid plans. I still contribute to my retirement account. I still think about long term. I still exercise to some degree a little bit. I still have a long view of the seminary I lead and being responsible. But at the same time, I got to tell you, if I'm not thinking all of that is contingent upon when Jesus comes back, I am failing in my understanding of the Christian life. The church that's healthy, they minister, they serve, they're prudent, they know the book of Proverbs, they plan, they save, they invest. But all of that has a big asterisk by it, a qualification that says, yet, we're waiting for Jesus to return. Yet, we're waiting for Jesus to return. My goal last night and this morning has been to challenge your understanding of the church and to challenge your understanding of the Christian life by impressing upon you the fact you cannot have a healthy Christian life apart from a healthy participation in a healthy church. And to challenge your understanding of the church that you can't have a healthy church without you being a healthy contributor to it. The church isn't some force or some group or some organization external to you you occasionally engage in and get something from. No, you are the church. You are the church. And when I see a church that is really firing on all eight cylinders, it always is with the people of God who are engaged and learning and growing and ministering together. And when that takes place, the sum far outstrips the subparts. When the people of God see what a healthy church is to be and they engage it, 1 + 1 begins to equal 5. Because the Spirit is working through that as you partner together to conduct the ministry of the church. So I pray that you would think carefully and intentionally on 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and do so with a sense of hopefulness and expectancy that as you seek to model and live these things, God will be pleased to do something extraordinarily special in this community of believers.